take out your Bibles and your outline sheets, and we're going to enter into a fantastic journey today into the Old Testament as we study the book of Esther. So far, you know, nothing has been said or evidence to show that in our study so far that Mordecai or Esther were really people of great dynamic faith. Now, there's some, I read all the commentaries I could find. I always like to hear what everyone has to say about things. But anyway, there are many commentaries that try to portray Esther and Mordecai as great men and women, a man and woman of faith all the way from the very beginning. I don't know where they see that, but anyway, my perspective is that they have not so far shown any great dynamic faith. And indeed, I believe already that we've seen that Mordecai has come alive in his faith. But remember, if he was just coming alive, he would be what we call a newbie, you know, as a Christian. You've all seen them. You were once that yourself, and so was I. But since faith was alive in them, all together, at critical levels of spiritual life, I believe that the same thing was happening, oh, perhaps in a lesser level, with the Jews in Susa as well. And God was going to bring their faith through the most trying and difficult experience of their lives. And you know, that's the kind of God we serve. He's like that. As one can see many times, just go through the Old Testament, all the way through the Old Testament, you will see that God shows us so that we can know and we can learn from teaching examples how God purifies his believers and their faith. Never leaves anyone, shall we say, at the newbie stage. Never leaves them there. Now, they might stay there for some time. Some grow faster and some a little bit slower. But everyone, if they're a true believer, will grow in their faith. And you know, I think of three individuals in particular. Probably one of the best examples is Abraham. Think about that. Abraham was forged through a lasting faith. How? Through many severe trials and suffering of his soul that he went through there. And then how about Joseph? Remember this young man who had a great future with his parents and his brothers, but of course they threw him and sold him as a slave, and he went to Egypt and went through the most terrible deprivations and trials, but God molded in Joseph an invincible faith, a beautiful faith. And of course, a lasting example is King David. We all know about him, and of course, his many sufferings here. Remember the hands of King Saul, and then his great fall with Bathsheba. Nonetheless, David came through, although scarred and broken by sin, but still firmly and steady in his faith. Now, so too, I see that Mordecai and Esther will be no different. So today in our study of chapter 4, Esther's moment of coming alive, her purification of faith, and our hour of destiny will be an exciting thing. Now indeed, God puts the spotlight of biblical history on Esther as she awakens her seeking faith and moves to the center, what I think, of human history. So let's familiarize ourselves with chapter 4 and let our gracious Lord take it from there and place it in your hearts as we will read the book of Esther chapter 4, the whole chapter. Now, I have it being read by a dramatic reading, and that always makes it extra special. But you can follow along, and here we go.
Chapter 4. When Mordecai learned of all that had been done, he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth and ashes, and went out into the city, wailing loudly and bitterly. But he went only as far as the king's gate, because no one clothed in sackcloth was allowed to enter it. In every province to which the edict and order of the king came, there was great mourning among the Jews, with fasting, weeping, and wailing. Many lay in sackcloth and ashes. When Esther's eunuchs and female attendants came and told her about Mordecai, she was in great distress. She sent clothes for him to put on instead of his sackcloth, but he would not accept them. Then Esther summoned Hathach, one of the king's eunuchs assigned to attend her, and ordered him to find out what was troubling Mordecai and why. So Hathach went out to Mordecai in the open square of the city in front of the king's gate. Mordecai told him everything that had happened to him, including the exact amount of money Haman had promised to pay into the royal treasury for the destruction of the Jews. He also gave him a copy of the text of the edict for their annihilation, which had been published in Susa, to show to Esther and explain it to her. And he told him to instruct her to go into the king's presence to beg for mercy and plead with him for her people. Hathach went back and reported to Esther what Mordecai had said. Then she instructed him to say to Mordecai,
"All the king's officials and the people of the royal provinces know that for any man or woman who approaches the king in the inner court without being summoned, the king has but one law, that they be put to death, unless the king extends the gold scepter to them and spares their lives. But 30 days have passed since I was called to go to the king."
When Esther's words were reported to Mordecai, he sent back this answer,
"Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this?"
Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai,
"Go, gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish."
So Mordecai went away and carried out all of Esther's instructions.
All right, that's great. Father, what an exciting text that we've heard read here from chapter 4. And I just pray now that we can glean from it many things that will help us in our own personal walk of faith. And Lord, help us understand even the literal meaning and understanding of what was happening at that particular time. So through all these things that we put into study today, I pray none of us will leave here without finding a better and a deeper walk of faith and understanding more about our own faith life and also about ourselves and our own sin nature that lies within us. I pray that if there's anyone under the sound of the word, perhaps on the internet, who doesn't know Christ as a personal Savior, may they see the need to receive Christ. May they see the need to turn away from that old nature of sin that has enveloped them since they were born. We pray for both of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, outline sheet. Of course, you have a copy there. We're going to look at a picture of grief, a pogrom of gloom, a plea for gallantry, and a plan for God. All these things surround two people, Mordecai and Esther, who are coming alive in their faith. Now, I want to go over one more thing I did last week because it's important to understand when we interpret the Word of God. The Old Testament, God says clearly, is a teaching tool of literal truths, but also allegories, which is, of course, figurative use of the Word of God, or another word that we use in modern day is application. You know, we can look at the Scripture, we can see what it means to the people of God to whom it was written, we can know exactly, literally, what it said there and how it's supposed to apply to them and to us, but then we can make applications of those things to a variety of our walk of faith and Christian application. Now, I feel it's necessary to again remind everybody of that very fact, that the Old Testament was written down for three things. Romans says to teach us. The book of Corinthians says has examples for us. And of course, Galatians 4 particularly zeroes in on what is we call figurative use of the Word of God. So without a doubt, we're going to study the Bible literally because every book in the Bible is to be studied and understood literally as it is written down. Because you know it and I know it, there are no errors, no corruption of content, for God has absolutely inspired every book and writing, and he has guided the writers, even if we don't know who the writers were, to absolute accuracy of everything, nothing excluded. How's that? That's how we believe the Bible. And we'll explore, of course, the happenings, as I said, and the book of Esther, perhaps more than a lot of the other books, it has been written down, and God's name has been left out. Biblical principles, in a sense, have been specifically left out so that the book has to be open for interpretation, and much of it can be figuratively, and we can learn a lot from it in that way. So we'll see how it fits in the teachings of God's ways in the hearts and lives of 21st century people. So let's begin with Esther chapter 4, verses 1 to 3. Now, when Mordecai learned of all that had been done, you know what we're talking about there. He tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and ashes. Now, Mordecai previously took a stand. Everyone bowed down to Haman because he had been given this high position next to the king. And any position like that near the king gave it a kind of a godlike ability. And, of course, Mordecai took that stand that he had, of course, now been elevated to a godlike character. And when they bowed down, he, in a sense, wanted a little worship from them as well. Well, Mordecai couldn't do that very thing. And, of course, the only way he could not do that was he had to explain why he couldn't do it. He was a Jew. Oh, my goodness. Now he was going to be displayed as a Jewish believer. Before that, he hid that aspect of him. You know, everyone knew that he had a Jewish heritage, but it wasn't a Jewish by faith. It was more a Jewish by being born into it. Well, Mordecai took a stand and declared he was now a practicing Jew. And there was a price to pay, as there always is, for anyone who declares they stand with God. In the Old Testament or in the New Testament, it really doesn't matter. So Mordecai couldn't have imagined how steep the price was going to be. His outward faith incited a genocide, the worst act imaginable, not only of him being declared to be put to death, but all the Jews in the entire realm of Persia. Oh, this was terrible. Every Jew who was now alive was going to be, because of the law that was written by Haman and King Xerxes, ruthlessly butchered and killed in the process when it was to be carried out. Now, I'm sure at the immediate revelation of this, Mordecai wondered, was it worth it all, really, for me not to bow? Surely I could have just bowed down a little bit, given him a little, you know, movement of the body. Maybe that would have satisfied him. But now, in a mind-numbing state, we find Mordecai in a picture of grief. That was his expression. Now, truly, God had won back a backslidden son of Israel, but at what price he would have to pay. Now, was this too much for God to handle? Did this overcome God? Did God not realize what was going to happen in this process here? Well, you and I know that's nonsense, right? Because our God is a sovereign God. Our God is an omnipotent God. Our God is an omnipresent God. Our God is an omniscient God. We call these the three non-communicable attributes of God. Now, why do I say that? Because no angel, devil or not, Satan or not, no human being can ever have these non-communicable attributes. They belong to God, because if anyone or any angel had them, then they would be God. There's only one God. Now, what does that mean in simple terms? Well, it means that God is in absolute control. He is all-powerful. He exists everywhere. There's no place you or I could go or hide and not be in the presence of God. God is everywhere. And at the same time, He is all-knowing. There's nothing He does not know about you and about me, about this world, about the kingdom of man. All of it is there. So before He created the worlds and the heavens, God knew everything possible, every move of a human being or an angel that they would make. Kind of like a chess game, right? It would be wonderful if you knew in advance that your opponent's every single move that he would even try to make against you. Well, you'd win every game as a result of that. So God arranged eternity like chess pieces. He had to accomplish His perfect will in and around what He had given you and me, free will. You know, I think it was A.W. Tozer. or